Hey guys, on today's review, we have the Rockford Fosgate DSR1 all-in-one digital processor.
So stay tuned. So it seems like right now digital processors are all the rage, and Rockford Fosgate has come out with theirs. It comes in a super sexy box, but we're not concerned about the box.
No.
We want to see what's inside.
So inside the box, you get a warranty card and a really basic one-page instruction manual. You also get the DSR1. And then you pinch here, pull up on the little foam insert, and underneath you'll find a USB for programming, and then two harnesses. One is an input, one is an output.
Wow, it's really pretty. But still, I don't know what it does and what it expects.
Fair enough. Let's talk about it for a little bit.
So inside this little box, we have digital signal processing with integrated Maestro CAN interface. We have 4-channel balanced differential RCA inputs. We have 4-channel high-level inputs with signal sense turn-on. We have remote turn-on input-output with adjustable turn-on delay. It has an auxiliary RCA input along with SPDIF coaxial inputs. It works with the optional PLC2 punch level control that has assignable functions through the brain.
It has 245 bands of equalization for aftermarket tuning, adjustable crossovers with selectable slopes of 6, 12, 18, 24, 30, 36, and 48 dB per octave.
Up to 10 milliseconds
of delay on each channel for time alignment. It's also Bluetooth 4.0 for convenient setup,
meaning you can use your phone to adjust it, and it works with iPhone and Android.
Wow, that's really impressive for this little box.
Mm-hmm.
But how can I integrate it with my car?
Let me show you how.
So there's 3 ways that you can integrate this with your car. So let's go ahead and take a look at each one individually. First, it's gonna be using the iDataLink Maestro T-Harness. These are for cars that have factory amplifiers built into them that are connected on the CAN bus. So for example, what we have here is a Ford and a couple Chryslers, but that's not all. If you go to the iDataLink Maestro website, down here you'll notice you can type in the car that you have. First, you're going to select a project. We want to go to amplifier replacement, then select make. As you can see here, we have Chrysler, Dodge, Fiat, Ford, Jeep, Maserati, Ram, and Universal mode. It's also going to be adding GM and Toyota, so make sure you check frequently to see if your car's manufacturer has been updated to the list. For this, we'll go ahead and select Chrysler. We'll select a year. Let's say we have a 2015. We'll say we have a 300. Do we have the Harman Kardon system? Yes. Now we can scroll down. We can see where the DSR1 is listed. We're gonna need an ACH3 T-harness. That's gonna be this harness right here. Now inside this box is going to be a harness so that you don't actually have to cut any of the wiring. You're going to go and plug this into the factory amplifier. And then on this end, you're going to have connections that are going to plug into your DSR. And then here's all your speaker wires that would go off for your aftermarket amplifier to power into this. Now on this end, you're gonna have the output, which is your RCAs that are gonna hook up to your aftermarket amplifier. What this allows you to do is essentially turn your factory Harman Kardon radio, in this case, into a full-on aftermarket radio. That 4 volts of output, that's gonna come out of these RCAs right here. This is also not high level to low level. This is full CAN digital, so we're getting a full 20 to 20,000 hertz signal directly into this, meaning there's no equalization, there's no bass roll-off, there's no problems whatsoever with that signal coming out of the radio. It's the exact same signal that's coming from the factory radio that would normally go into the amplifier. You're not gonna lose any of your door chimes, you're not gonna lose any backup sensors, warning lane departure, navigation, factory Bluetooth, all that is gonna function the exact same way it does now, just you're gonna have a cool EQ DSP crossover that's gonna be added to your factory radio controlled by your smart device. The second type of install involves you using your factory radio that isn't compatible with any of the iDataLink Maestros and has just a standard 4-channel output, meaning left, rear, front, right. This has a high-level 4-channel input. On the side of the unit located right here, it has the high-level, low-level. So if you're gonna be using your factory radio, you're gonna wanna select the high-level switch. Make sure you do this. Next, you're gonna wanna grab the rainbow-colored harness, this guy right here. And the reason why I say that is when you compare it to the other harness, this one just has red and white on it. This one has a ton of different colors. Specifically, it has gray, green, white, and purple. These are the standard colors associated with an aftermarket radio's front, rear, left, right. So for example, the white is the driver's front, the gray is the passenger front, the green is the driver's rear, and the purple is the passenger rear. These are the set of wires you're gonna wanna connect to your factory radio to get the 4-channel input into your DSR1. The orange one here is the SP diff input, and then this is an auxiliary input. You also have a remote input and a remote output. For the high level application, you're just going to be using the remote output. This is going to use signal sense to generate the remote turn on, meaning when it has sound come from this radio, it's going to create its own remote turn on to turn on the amplifiers. You also have a constant 12 volts yellow and a black ground. If you don't want to cut your RCANs off of this and hardwire it, Rockford has thought of that. They make this guy right here. This is the RFIF2SW, or high level to RCA. Inside, you have this guy right here. This is just a set of speaker wires that you can connect to your factory harness and drop a set of RCA outputs. Then you can run a set of RCAs from here to wherever you have your DSR1. Now once you get the DSR1 connected to your aftermarket radio, you're gonna go ahead and hook it up to your aftermarket amplifiers. So on here, you have 8 channels of output. So you can do front, rear, sub, or any other combination of these 8 channels. The third install type is if you already have an aftermarket radio in the car like this one, and you want to add the huge EQ that's in this so that you could possibly do something like network mode, time correction, have a better, more extensive crossover, or you just want to be able to control all those sound settings from your smartphone. To do that, go ahead and grab that same rainbow colored plug and grab your gray, purple, green, and white inputs, and they're gonna connect to the front and rear outputs of your existing radio. You can use the remote output from your aftermarket radio to go into the input of your DSR1 and then connect the output remote turn on to your aftermarket amplifiers. Now, the other thing you wanna make sure is also on the side of the DSR1, you select low level input this time. Next, you wanna go ahead and connect for your amplifier output. There again, this has 8 channels of selectable output to go to your aftermarket amplifiers. Now as a bonus, there's one extra way that you can also connect your DSR1 into your car, and that is using the aux input here. Using the aux input, you can connect it to this guy right here. This is the Rockford Fosgate RFBT-RCA. This is a Bluetooth dongle to RCA adapter. You could take this guy right here and plug it directly into this. Now what that'll allow you to do is if you are using the high level inputs, you can use the PLC2 as an external volume knob. So you can program it to use this guy here to control the level of your Bluetooth. That way you can get a straight Bluetooth signal into the DSR1 bypassing the factory system. You can also use it as just a standalone. So let's say you have a car that has no radio and you don't want to put one in the dash, you can put the Bluetooth module in with the LPC2 as the main volume control and control it all from there. So there are some unique installs that you can do by adding some extra parts to it.
All right, so you told me what it does and how to connect it to my car.
Yeah.
But now, how can I control it?
Well, that's a great question, and I have an answer for you.
All right.
Let me show you how.
So there's 3 ways that you could control your DSR1. You can use a Windows-based computer, you can use some form of a tablet, or you can use some form of a smartphone. For this, we're just gonna concentrate on the tablet. So once you apply power to your DSR, there's a power light located right here. This is gonna tell you the status of the unit. Right now, it's all set and ready to go. We've gone ahead and launched the app. Click the Bluetooth icon, and it should appear at the top here. Depending on how many of them you have, they will scroll down.
This one is connected, so we'll go ahead and select home.
On your home, you have 2 choices on what you can do.
The first is the subwoofer level, and the second is the punch EQ. Now, this is fully customizable.
If you don't want the punch EQ, you don't have to have it on here. The other thing you'll notice is this eye up here in the top corner. If you select it, it's gonna go ahead and launch the instruction manual. You can flick through and it'll walk you through basic setup on the unit. It'll also give you examples of pages that are inside of it. If you're familiar with it, you can just select skip or select okay, got it. So on the main page, you have three buttons across the bottom. Bluetooth, like we just talked about, tune, and setup. When you select setup, this is where you're going to get to the nuts and bolts of it. It's where you're gonna find the ability to program these outputs to do what you want. If you're gonna connect it to an iDataLink Maestro, or if you're gonna do high level or low level from, let's say, a factory or aftermarket radio. When you select tune, you're gonna get the option to do basic tune or advanced tuning. So on the basic tune screen, you have a 7-band EQ, and you use these cursors to move your cursor up, down, left, right. So if we select up here, we can come over, move this up, move this down, and across the top here, we'll see the frequency we're dealing with, as well as the volume gain or negative gain. If you hit the eye in the top corner, it'll go ahead and give you that instruction manual we were talking about. Select OK, read it, select OK, select OK. Now, in the top left-hand corner, you'll see the home icon. Go ahead and tap that. Now you're good to go as far as you have a basic EQ setup. If you select tune again and select advanced, here you're gonna find a lot more stuff to play with. You have trim level. This is going to give you volume control of all 8 of your RC outputs. So you can come in here and turn them down as a group, or select the chain unchained and you can turn up one specifically. This is very helpful if you're doing time correction and one speaker sounds louder than the next, or if you're using these to, let's say, control some tweeters and you'd like to turn them down a bit. In time alignment, you select milliseconds, inches, or centimeters. Up here in the right top corner next to the eye for information, they have a tape measure. What this allows you to do is go in and measure where your head is to each one of the 8 channels, or 6 channels, depending on how you have it set up. Once you put these in, select save, it'll go ahead and add in and do the math to adjust the milliseconds for you. Very helpful. Once you get into the crossover page, you'll notice up here by the eye, there's a speaker. If you tap it, you could select what speaker you'd like to crossover. So in this case, it's set up as a front rear sub. So right now, the fronts are selected. We'll select close. We can come over here and we can scroll left and right on filter type and decide what type of crossover it's gonna be. We have a choice of high pass, low pass, band pass, or all pass, which is essentially off. And as we said earlier, we have 6, 12, 18, 24, 36, and 42, and 48 dB per octave. And what that means is we'll come over here and we'll change the frequency a bit. We'll scroll to 6, and as you can see, this has a really gradual roll-off. You're gonna get a lot of mid-bass. If you have too much, you can adjust it, and it will stop that. It'll give it a much steeper roll-off. On this side is where you choose the frequencies you want. You just scroll across here, and then it'll go ahead and move. Now, to do a band pass, you have the high pass and low pass both adjustable at the same time. So then you can decide where your cutoffs are, meaning this is the only sound you're gonna be getting out of that channel. You can adjust the crossover slopes. Now last, we have equalizer. As we saw on the previous EQ, we just had the 7 bands of equalization. This one has a whole lot more. We are still going to use our arrows to adjust here, but then we've also added gain, Q, and frequency. So if we select frequency, we can move across the bar, as you can see the little white cursor moving, and then we can select gain, and we can move up. And if we come back and select Q, Q is gonna adjust the width of what we just moved. Now, if we're tapping here, as you can notice the numbers up here, the Q is changing. We can also just put our finger on the screen, pull down, or push up, and it will adjust the Q as well. The Q is how boomy or how dry, meaning less influence on the frequencies next to it, it will have. So if you have a problem at a specific frequency, you may want a very narrow Q, or if you'd like something a little bit more that's gonna bother its friends, you can pick a wider Q. If you don't like it at all, you could select reset EQ. Select home. Now in the top right-hand corner where it says main, this is if you're going to be using the auxiliary input. If
if you tap it,
it will go ahead and select the auxiliary. That could be for that Bluetooth dongle like we were talking about. Now, the one last thing that's in setup that's gonna be useful is you tap setup, manage presets. Go ahead and tap that. Here's where your presets are gonna be, meaning you just spent all that time setting up your crossovers, time correction, and EQ. You may want to save that. Here's where you're gonna do that.
All right, there you go, Fernando. It's a pretty versatile product, don't you think?
Oh, definitely, it's really cool, yes.
Well, if you guys would like to know more about this, don't worry, we're gonna have more videos on the product, such as setting it up, programming all those outputs in the setup menu. We didn't have time to do that on this one because this one was running a wee bit long. So let's go ahead and wrap this one up. What do you say, Fernando?
All right, if you like this video, please subscribe, share, like, thumbs up. You know what you guys do. You know where you find us. Also, Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, also on Twitter.
And if you'd like to support the show, we also have a Patreon account, so check that out. And a podcast. Awesome. All right, guys, you have a great night as always, and we'll see you later next time.
Bye.
Bye.